Today I'm talking with Nancy about coastal landscape changes at Palaikastro, Eastern Crete, from the late Neolithic to the Minoan and historical periods. And we are going to discuss our preliminary results of the sedimentological and the bioarchaeological study of two coves from the Curemenos wetland near the Minoan town of Palaikastro. This study adds to recent landscape, paleoenvironmental, on-site geoarchaeological and bioarchaeological on-site and off-site evidence obtained by the team of the Palaikastro LATS program called PALAP that was designed to provide, among other things, an integrated view of the Minoan town within its landscape. Throughout the long and rich history of archaeological investigations on Crete, research agendas focused mainly on the emergence and the demise of the complex social and political Bronze Age organizations and their material and ideological manifestations, whereas their operation within their wider landscape and environmental context remain usually unclear. In this context, the main aims of our integrated geoarchaeological and bioarchaeological analysis were to provide new insights into the coastal landscape and the environmental history around the Bronze Age urban center of Palaikastro, to explore the impact of human and other drivers on the evolution of the coastal setting, and unavoidably, to investigate the occurrence of thera eruption-related deposits in the sedimentary sequence and its possible impacts in the coastal zone and beyond. To achieve our goals, we sampled two cores retrieved for a multi-proxy paleoenvironmental analysis, as you see right, left below in the slides, using a hand-operated Russian auger. The cores are only 50 meters apart, so a comprehensive paleogeographic reconstruction of the Palaikastro alluvial plain is not feasible at this stage of research. And this is the reason we consider the work presented here only as preliminary. The local chronostratigraphy was built from 8 radiocarbon dates, and the smoothing age depth model was constructed for the fine textured, rich, organic rich intervals present in both cores. Thus, the lower securely dated segments of the cores cover the time span from 4,300 to 2,500 years BCE, in other words, from the late Neolithic to the early Minoan 2A periods, whereas data are also available for time windows during the middle Minoan and the medieval periods. Finally, although systematic faunal analysis has been completed, post-Bronze Age sediments have been only spot analyzed. Completion of analytical work, we are afraid, must await the end of the pandemic. Consequently, today we will focus on the late Neolithic phases and the Bronze Age, and we will discuss very briefly later chronological periods and landscape phases. So, having highlighted the limitation of our research, I will very briefly show you our methodology and then focus on the results of our analysis. Physical and chemical characterization of sediment analysis followed the standard laboratory procedures, and as you can see on the slide, and the same applies to faunal analysis. And this slide that you see now presents the sedimentology and fauna from cores 5 and 7, summarizing the sedimentary sequence, the positional environments, and chronology. As you can see, both cores record similar sedimentary sequences that can be divided in 7 landscape units. I will start with the first, the lower. By the early phases of the late Neolithic, open, low vegetation dominated the Palaikastro region, whereas the forest cover was especially thin and patchy. In the littoral plain of Curemenos, a low-energy oligohaline estuary was already present, whereas the significant presence of dung-related fungal spores indicates that flocks of grazing animals exploited intensively the coastal environment. The pollen and non-pollen palynomorph evidence, studied by Canelas, Bolta, and Riera Morta, our colleagues from Barcelona, indicate incipient small-scale agriculture and declining grazing pressure in the vicinity of the coring site during the later part of the late Neolithic. The estuary continued to receive fine-grained sediments. Faunal evidence indicates that the estuary environment was under stress due to occasional marine intrusions and freshwater influxes, especially after 3,800 to 3,700 years BCE. A possible expansion of the estuary, implied by the faunal evidence, may be responsible for the decline of grazing activity in the vicinity of the coring site. Interestingly, although agropastoral activities are clearly visible in the paleoenvironmental record, to date there is no direct archaeological evidence of late Neolithic or earlier occupation in the Palaeocastro catchment. And although the Cretan Neolithic issue is beyond the scope of this presentation, we believe that Neolithic sites should be shot in different settings, such as Neogene plateaus, Pleistocene terraces, or the locally extensive submerged or alluviated lowlands, though systematic surface surveys and targeted systematic surface surveys and targeted geoarchaeological exploration. Moving to the second unit, the final Neolithic so significant, possibly fire-induced opening up of the shrubby vegetation, coeval expansion of cereals and olive, as well as a decline of local pastoral activities. Importantly, elevated olive values may indicate intensive or specialized olive management around the coring locality. From around 3200 BCE onwards, however, both the pollen and NPP data record the short phase of agricultural decline in tandem with first grassland and then shrubby vegetation recovery. At the same time, initial low herding activity recovered after around 3,100 years BC in the littoral zone, where an open lagoon or shallow marine water body exhibiting significant fluctuations in salinity and episodic alluvial deposition was established, at least since the final Neolithic I or in the transition between final Neolithic I and II. Lagoonal conditions prevailed until the early phases of the early Minoan I period. A second, presently undated alluvium, identified in both coring localities, reached the lagoon sometime before the early Minoan I period. Both alluvia are thin and comprise fine-grained and rather organic sediments, implying small-scale gradual erosion of the topsoils in the catchment. Moreover, the faunal evidence reveals a clear and quick recovery of the aquatic environment and suggests that final Neolithic alluviation had a limited impact on the environment and the coastal landscape. Available archaeological evidence places first occupation of the area surrounding Palaeocastro in the final Neolithic II period, following similar developments all over Crete, as Novici has shown. Settlements on promontories like the Castri and rocky ridges like Petsofas and possibly Maritati overlook coastal and other lowlands that may have constituted their economical territories. On current evidence, therefore, substantial clearing, expansion of agricultural land and herding activities, most likely associated with the intensification of settlement during the final Neolithic II period, left for the first time a clear imprint on both sedimentary and faunal records. Increased human pressure on the landscape, however, has not resulted in catastrophic soil erosion, significant sediment accumulation, and changes in the coastal configuration. At the beginning of the early Minoan I period, the landscape experienced a renewed land clearance by fire, expansion of both annual crops and olive, and increased grazing pressure that resulted in a highly degraded terrain, dominated by olive trees and grasslands. In the coastal zone, a significant, albeit short-lived shift from a lagoonal shallow marine to a marsh environment of deposition is evident in both coring localities. Sediments are coarser textured and less organic than the underlying lagoonal shallow marine deposits, indicating that this new phase of anthropogenic impact has probably triggered erosion of the subsoils in the catchment and sediment deposition in the coastal zone, evidenced by the presence of three, also undated, discrete alluvia identified in both coring localities. Later in the early Minoan period, a significant land cover change took place. Oak and pine started to recover partially in higher elevations. At the same time, grassland expansion and concomitant reduction of shrubby vegetation, high presence of dung-related fungal spores, further expansion of olive and annual crops, and the possible appearance for the first time of grape crops points to an important agropastoral expansion, continuous and intense use of both the littoral plain and the slopes. In the littoral zone, this lagoonal or shallow marine conditions were re-established. Variation in presence, representation, and taphonomy of faunal remains indicates increasing freshwater influx with time. During the early Minoan to A period, there was a further expansion of the areas devoted to olive husbandry and or cultivation that went hand in hand with animal keeping and grazing activities. Moreover, it seems that the long tradition of burning to maintain an open vegetation started to wither. In the coastal zone, this lagoon shallow marine environment exhibits stronger freshwater inputs than during the previous early Minoan period. Settlement density and settlement pattern haven't changed much during this period. The settlement of Palaeokastro, that later became one of the largest Bronze Age urban centers of Crete, has been established during the early Minoan period near the coast. Reorganization of settlement location and settlement patterns that began in the middle late early Minoan I and consolidated in the early Minoan II period is clearly reflected in the Palaeo environmental record that implies that the landscape was also functionally restructured to support complex and complementary land uses and agropastoral activities on both the slopes and the lowlands around Palaeokastro. In the coastal zone, the aquatic environment sustained throughout the early Minoan I and early Minoan II periods, despite the short-lived drying up phase at the beginning of the early Minoan I. By the middle Minoan I-A, the vegetation structure remained fairly stable. Olive crops continue to occupy extensive areas, while there is a reduction in cereal crops. Interestingly, the increase in grazing pressure attested in the pollen and NPP registers may imply the beginning of ovic upright flock management specialization in the town's territory, which can be tentatively correlated with the first indications of landscape and soil management. Through the establishment of farmsteads and the construction of terraces, check dams and enclosures in the town hinterland, as research by Orengo and Napet has shown, and Alexandra explained in detail previously. Settlement dynamics, landscape organization, land use, and soil management to prevent erosion have resulted in relatively slope stability and gradual sedimentation during the protopalaeocene period, as indicated by the micromorphological study near the New Palaeokastro excavations by Rachel Coolidge. In the coast, the lagoon was occupied that occupied the Curemenos littoral zone since the second half of the 5th millennium BC began to dry up gradually, possibly due to the 4.2 before present aridification event. A relatively thick fluvial deposit identified in both coring localities marks a shift in sentiment dynamics and the transition from a lagoon shallow marine to a regressive environment of deposition. It comprises coarse sands and gravels in a silty matrix with a wetting episode in the middle of the unit. This unit is not clearly dated and it was deposited at some time between the MM1A and late Minoan 3A2 periods. Poor chronological control does not allow a full grasp of the environment and landscape history of the Palaeokastro coastal plain for the crucial 500 years. In other words, for the period between middle Minoan 1B and LM3A1. The integration of landscape survey, excavation, on-site geoarchaeological and bioarchaeological evidence generated by the PALAP project, however, allows valuable, although tentative, insights into the landscape and land use of the Palaeokastro coastal plain at this period. The landscape remained generally open and largely agropastoral, As already mentioned, several middle to late Minoan farmsteads identified in the town's territory used terraces, enclosures and check dams to maximize agricultural production, to manage flocks of sheep and goats and conserve soil and water. Strategies to mitigate erosion seem to have been successful, as confirmed by the on-site micromorphology results, indicating only gradual deposition of alluvial, beach or aeolian sediments in and around the new Palap excavations until the late Minoan 1A period. The picture changes radically after the Thera eruption. Excavation and micromorphological evidence prove that tephra deposits identified at Palaikastro were redeposited or reworked by multiple flooding events that occurred probably soon after the tephra fallout in Eastern Crete. Flash floods associated with accelerated erosion impacted sometimes violently the built environment of the main urban center and the new Palap neighborhood by the end of the Neopalatial period and later. Therefore, the distinct gravelly silt unit identified in both coring localities can be tentatively interpreted as post-Thera eruption flash flood deposits that reached the drying lagoon sometime before the late Minoan 3A2. It should be stressed that our data do not provide evidence for the presence of tephra or tsunami-related deposits in the Curemeno sedimentary sequence. But as the Malia team will demonstrate in a few minutes, potential evidence on the impact of the Thera eruption tsunami, if there was any, must be sought further inland, away from the highly dynamic littoral setting. A wet, organic-rich environment, perhaps a small estuary, has been established in the Coring 5 locality during the late Minoan 3 period and can be tentatively associated with post-Thera eruption hydrological changes in the catchment. By the 13th and 14th century AD, at least 3 meters thick deposits blanketed the study area, and the landscape started to resemble its present-day morphology. Red colors and high magnetic susceptibility values imply accelerated soil erosion of the limestone Palaikastro catchment, possibly associated with prolonged abandonment, neglect of soil conservation measures, and or climatic drivers. Finally, at some point unknown at present, post-dating the 4th century AD, low-energy organic reeds, nearly hypoxic and possibly ephemeral freshwater pools and ponds, were established locally in the littoral zone. So, to conclude, integration of sediment and faunal study of the Curemenos archive with the rich and multi-proxy Palap dataset provide new insights into the coastal landscape history near the Bronze Age urban center of Palaikastro. Our preliminary data reveal that a lagoon or a shallow marine environment occupied the littoral Curemenos locality from at least the second half of the 5th millennium BCE. They also suggest that alluvial deposition associated with the final Neolithic and early Minoan human landscape interactions has impacted but not transformed the coastal environment. Importantly, the viable landscape and agropastoral management regime established from the late early Minoan and consolidated during the middle Minoan and the late Minoan periods resulted in sustainable landscape and environmental disturbances. The situation changed dramatically after the Thera eruption when sizable high energy flash floods deposits impacted the coastal zone. Medieval or earlier accelerated soil erosion and rapid sediment deposition blanketed the Palaikastro lowlands and resulted in the creation of the environments that presently occupy the coastal plain. Future analytical work will address post-Bronze Age hiatuses and uncertainties in our knowledge. And the final note, We strongly believe that the tsunami issue at Palaikastro will remain inconclusive until the implementation of a targeted excavation campaign near the shore and systematic field and analytical research inland that will hopefully shed new light to this much debated issue. Thank you very much for the attention.